you want to hear? Does anybody know my music? How many of you don't know my music? You can go ahead and raise your hand. She doesn't. I suspected as much. You don't.
We had this discussion at lunch.
Well, you're familiar with my music, but you don't know my name.
I do know your name.
I really do. Really,
you do now. Wait, isn't there a Beatles song like that?
Maybe.
There's a country song.
I know your number. I know your number.
I know your number.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Well, I'm going to start with Psalm 95. And this is at the beginning of the Roman Liturgy of the Hours for what's called the Invitatory, or the Office of Prime. So that comes before Lauds. And it reminds us to begin every day with an attitude of gratitude. Because I don't know about you guys, but the older I get, I wake up in the morning and sometimes it hurts in many places. It aches here, it aches there, and I don't always feel like praising God. So the office reminds me to wake up and go, thank you, Lord. You know, another day, praise God. So I wrote this in a little hermitage that I built down by a creek in Indianapolis, Indiana, in 1978. And I recorded it on a record called Come to the Quiet. And I recorded this really based on a setting of the psalm, which was just for me. I sang it all by myself in a hermitage. And it's come to be used more congregationally, which is kind of interesting, because that's not why I wrote the psalm or how I set it to music. But come, worship the Lord, for we are His people, the flock that He shepherds. Alleluia. So I'm going to ask you to, if you don't want to sing, you don't have to. If you want to, you can. But mainly I want to take anything in our life that, I just drove in from the south side of Dallas. It was typical drive on I-45, you know. Some of it was quite lovely. Got towards Houston and it became less lovely. So we need to turn anything in our life today that might have been maybe a little aggravating, maybe a little nerve-wracking, turn it around to God. Even though you work in a retreat center, those things happen here too, because I live in a religious community. So everybody thinks it's heaven on earth when they come here, but you know better, because you know what it's like in the belly of the beast. Come, worship the Lord. For we are His people, the flock that He shepherds. Alleluia. Come, let us sing to the Lord and shout with joy to the rock who saves us. Let us come with thanksgiving and sing joyful songs to the Lord. Come, worship the Lord, for we are His people, the flock that He shepherds. worship and praise is like this. When, and most of the opening hymns at Mass are really worship and praise. During Lent, it's more penitential. But especially as we enter into the Easter season, they're worship and praise. So it's like this. Everything goes up. So we're letting go of ourself when we worship and praise God. It's an upward like this. But meditation is different. Meditation is a downward letting go of self. Both let go of self. One is kind of energetic. Boom. Worship and praise is energetic like that. Meditation is not energetic. It's very still. And you just let the old self fall away. Like an old set of clothes that doesn't fit very well. When you lose weight, you know, you go put on your old set of clothes and it just kind of falls off. I have the opposite problem right now because we just came out of, you know, Easter celebration. So we had a lot of sweets in our community. So I've got to shed about 2 or 3 pounds. So I'm going to begin working on that to get back. And so sometimes the old clothes fall off because we can't fasten them. They fall off. But one way or the other, like an old set of clothes, it doesn't fit, right? So this is God alone is enough prayer. And it comes from St. Teresa of Avila. But God alone is enough. Let nothing trouble you. So I want you to sit straight, put your feet flat on the floor, rest your hands out on your lap if you can, open your hands up, and if you're not filming this, let go of anything you're hanging on to. This is a great symbol of emptiness, openness to the Lord. So we don't grasp anything at all. This is really important for those of us who work in the church or who work in ministries. Sometimes even in ministry, we begin to grasp things, don't we? Like they're ours. It's important in ministry. Everything is God's. Everything is God's. None of it is ours. So, nothing trouble you, and let nothing frighten you, for everything passes, but God will never change. Change. Jesus walked the earth, he was a healer, and he's a healer still. So where do we need healing today? Could be a physical ailment, a sickness, an injury, an illness, a disease. For most of us, it's the way we think. Maybe we allow our thoughts to go to negative things too easily. And when we do that, then instead of our emotions empowering good and positive things, they begin to enable negative and destructive things. And when that happens, it sets off a negative process that can even make us sick and ill. And the whole thing starts all over again, doesn't it? So let's bring all that we are, body, soul, and spirit, to the cross of Jesus. Just let it go. Let it go. Let Jesus have everything so that he can heal us completely. We just went through Holy Week, and we heard from the reading of Isaiah at the Easter Vigil that by his stripes we are healed. Jesus heals us. Table, we were talking at lunch that Gary Yonick is a longtime family friend of my wife, Viola's family. She grew up in the Victoria Diocese. He was a priest over in the Victoria Diocese. So I think it's 42 years he's been a friend of the family. As she says, he knows every sin the family has committed. And he's now the auxiliary bishop over in San Antonio. So he invited me to come over and to do something for the Eucharistic Revival in San Antonio. And I spent a little over a week there doing things in parishes all around the diocese. We had just some really, really successful parish events. And I did some things for, various leaders in the diocese. It was just a lot of fun. But he wanted me to sing and to teach about the Eucharist. And I have a book out called The Lord's Supper, a Eucharistic Revival, that is doing really well, and a little compilation CD called Adoration that goes along with it. And as I taught, I went from the book, which goes through the Mass, literally just section at a time. And it's a little retreat book. It's not hard to read, and it's made for popular consumption, but it has, good solid scholarship behind it. But the part I shared about, and this is what I'm going to share with you briefly this afternoon. When I was here in Houston at St. Clair's years ago, 5.5 years ago, I was coming to the end of struggling with some sickness. I was passing out, experiencing what's called syncope. So I was out on the road doing concerts and missions like Father Cedric does. Hi, Father Cedric. And I would be, you know, doing missions. I'd be in a hotel, and I would just pass out. Well, needless to say, this is inconvenient. So I would go to hospitals, and they would try to find out what was going on, and they found out that I had real bad blood pressure problems. At first, it was very low, and then it was very high. So they had given me all, I'd gone to heart doctors and so on and so forth. Here at, and they thought they had it straightened out. Here at Houston, I woke up in the middle of the night one night, my blood pressure was 220 plus, over 110 plus, and I had this screaming, pounding headache. And they called 911. They took me about 4 minutes down the street to Methodist Hospital, and I spent a couple of days there at Methodist trying to straighten me out. And during that time, I hurt so bad, I wanted to pray, but I couldn't, because it hurt to think. I couldn't think objective, because I couldn't think objective thoughts, because I had such a bad headache. So all I could do, I wanted to praise God, so all I could do was mumble in tongues. So it wasn't particularly Pentecostal. I just lay in the hospital bed and went like that. But I was praising God, and it went on for hours. In the middle of this experience, I had an out-of-body experience where my angel, I knew it was my guardian angel, grabbed me literally under this shoulder, my left arm. And another angel, I'm pretty sure it was the angel of death, grabbed me under this arm. And they lifted me out of my hospital bed, and they took me out. And they let me see paradise at a distance. Now, saints get to see it up close. I didn't get to see it up close. I didn't get to see my relatives and other saints and the apostles and the prophets. You know, I didn't get to, you know, talk to him. I was way out at a distance, but I got to see him. And I knew two things all at once. And this was intuitive. Now keep in mind, this is outside of space and time. I don't know how long I was there. I knew all my sins intuitively. And I wept. I knew all my sins. And I knew all of God's mercy. Like that. So I knew I was forgiven, but I knew all my sins. And all I could do was weep. And when they finally released me and they let me go back home, every time I prayed, this lasted for months, and well over a year, all I could do was weep. With the Eucharistic revival, this had powerful significance for me, because the Mass exploded. It just exploded. Because specifically, the Eucharistic prayer. Now the whole Mass exploded, but the Eucharistic prayer, and specifically when we get to the consecration, just the top of the church peeled back, and heaven and earth, and it still happens for me, come together. A little chapel like this or in our place at Little Portion Hermitage and Monastery, or a big place, a big parish like Prince of Peace, you guys were just at Prince mm-hmm. of Peace, they are crowded, they are jam-packed with all the angels and saints and the congregation. Doesn't matter whether it's 2 or 3 or 3,000. It's packed. Heaven and earth meet. And at the consecration, Jesus ceases to be just a word on a page or a story from the past. And his entire life, and especially his death on the cross, for, in my case, I'll just speak personally, for me personally, is now. Right now. Because what's happening on the altar represents what happened on Calvary right now. Also, the empty tomb is right now. The ascension is right now. The gift of the Spirit in the upper room is right now. It's all now. And this is a little interesting fact. Bishop Gary really liked this, by the way, Cedric. There's an Orthodox theologian, his name is Alexander Schmemann. And he said, modern humanity has lost the classical understanding of memory. In the classical understanding of memory, the thing remembered or the person remembered is fully present when you remember completely. So the memorial sacrifice, Jesus is fully present. Fully present. Powerful. So when you go to Mass, brothers and sisters, we are on Calvary. We are on the dusty roads of Galilee. We are on Calvary at the foot of the cross. We are at the empty tomb. We are meeting Him risen in Galilee. We are on the Mount of Olives as He ascends. We are in the upper room when the Holy Spirit is given. We are right there. Can you imagine? And that is the beauty of the Mass. We get to be right there. It wasn't just for them. It's for us. And that's why the Mass was instituted. And that's why the church celebrated it every time they got together on Sunday. That's why. So that it could be right now for each one of us. Sorry to be preachy. But the Eucharistic revival is trying to bring us back to the heart of what the Mass is about. I'm convinced that if we really, I used to ask my spiritual father, I used to say, how can you get through it? And I asked guys like Father Cedric, how do you get through it without just weeping and being rapt? And he told me, he says, and he's the one, he's Saint Diadoke of, or Saint Diadochus of our of Photiki in the office. It's actually not in the office of readings, but in one of his writings, he said there are two anointings. One is for personal sanctification. And that anointing of the Spirit, all you can do is weep. when you are under that anointing of the Spirit, all you can do is cry. And there's another anointing for ministry so that you can function. Like what I'm doing here today. Like what you do, Father, when you celebrate the Mass. And Father Martin used to tell me, he said, when I celebrate the Mass, I kind of have to just kind of function so that I can give Jesus to others. You guys have to do the same thing here. Sometimes you just have to kind of get on with it and make the place work, don't you? Keeping in mind what you are giving to these ladies here today on this Acts retreat, who are going to have their lives changed. And they will, and they are, if the Acts retreat is doing what it usually does. Right?
Yeah.
And if you guys don't just function under that anointing for ministry, that won't happen here. I'll sing one more. Surrender to Jesus. That's what we all have to do, isn't it? Whether we're in clerical ministry, whether we're in consecrated life or consecration of life, or whether we're in lay ministry of any kind, we all have to surrender to Jesus so that we can be his hands and his feet, his eyes, his ears. Take all my freedom, my liberty, my will.
Compassion on this world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands. Yours. compassion on this world. Christ has no body now on earth, but yours.
Well, thank you all.